Hi, everybody. Alan Arnette here with another podcast and the blog on alanarnette.com. It is an interesting day for me. It is May 21st, 2024, but today, 13 years ago, May 21st, 2011, I stood on top of the world. I summited Mount Everest. So I thought I would take a little personal liberty here to talk a little bit about my experience of summiting Mount Everest. As I've been talking about fictional characters like Harper with Everyday Everest and the real life characters that are up there right now. In fact, it's going to be another big day on Everest, probably in the morning, May 22nd, 2024. Some of you know my story, probably most of you don't, but I didn't start climbing until I was 38 years old. I got a degree in electrical engineering, went to work for Hewlett-Packard, mainly in management, discovered mountains when I was living in Geneva, Switzerland, climbed Mont Blanc. Loved it. Just absolutely fell in love with it. Took a trip to Everest Base Camp in 1997. Saw the Himalaya. Saw Everest. I saw Arnette Blanc, that 22,000 pointy peak. Some arguably say it's the most beautiful mountain in the world. When I looked at it, I said, nobody can climb that. It's unclimbable. 2 years later, I stood on top of it. I saw Mount Everest through a different vantage point. I was climbing with adventure consultants, and the Kiwi guide, David Hiddleston, said, so mate, I guess it's time for you to start thinking about Everest. And I did. I began to set my sights on it, and I went to Troy, OU first, see how my body reacted to 8,000 meters. It wasn't pretty. I got to 8,000 meters, just a little bit shy of the summit, something I still regret to this day for not pushing more. I didn't realize the strength, the reservoir that as humans we have. It's untapped until we tap it. I discovered that on K2 years later. I went to Everest in 2002. Wasn't pretty. Repeated it in 2003. Even uglier. Both times, I had committed the greatest sin that a climber can commit. That's the sin of arrogance. I overestimated my capability, and I underestimated how hard the mountain is. Trust me, Everest is not a walk-up. Don't believe a thing when people say that. I went back in 2008. That was about a year before my mom died from Alzheimer's. I began to use my climbing as a way to honor my mother. I made a vow to Ida Arnette that I was not going to let her death become just another number on a long list of people taken by this horrible disease. So I began to dedicate my climbs to her and to raise money for Alzheimer's nonprofits. But even with that change of why, I still wasn't strong enough. I didn't make it again. That year was tough for me. I almost gave up. In fact, I did give up. I just said, it's impossible. I can't do it. I know people summit Everest, but I can't do it. But I came back home and I saw my mom and how she dealt with her Alzheimer's with such dignity, sense of humor. And I began to think, I can't let her down. I'm going to go back and do this. You know, by that time I had about a million people following my blog. So I had a platform, I had a voice, and now I had a message. So I ended up getting sponsorship through Johnson & Johnson to go climb the seven summits. Fast forward into May, I'm climbing with International Mountain Guides. We've gone through the acclimatization rotations. I'm so, so lucky and fortunate that by the luck of the draw, Ang Jangbu Sherpa, who was leading the base camp along with Greg Gravanovich, they had selected Kami Sherpa to be my personal Sherpa. It could not have been a better match. Kami was a gentle soul, incredibly strong, a father of five, and a super, super human being. We instantly clicked. One night we're at Camp 3, the winds start picking up, and we're both holding up the tent with our hands, and we're kind of laughing at the situation, even though it's deadly. A few days later, went back down, went back up to the South Col, got there. Good time, made good time from Camp 3 to the Col. All of a sudden, I was climbing like there was no tomorrow. I was strong. I was confident. I was going faster than I ever had, especially faster than the previous three times. Got to the South Col. We started seeing people come down. The winds are blowing like crazy. Just again, just like being in a hurricane, but inside a nylon tent. I was actually in the tent with a really good friend, Miriam. 38 years old from Germany, She was there with her husband at the time, Jay. He had turned back, went down on the base of the Lhotse face. So it was just Miriam and I. We were in the tent that afternoon, wind just howling, trying to get some sleep. And the forecast from Michael Fagan from Everest Weather said the winds are going to stop at 8 o'clock that night. Sure enough, just like somebody walked over to the wall and hit a light switch. Silence. Alan, Miriam, let's go. Kami called out to us. We quickly rushed out of the tent in our down suits. Kami came over with an oxygen bottle, put it in my backpack. Mountain Hardware South Cole, great pack. Crampons go on my boots. Kami and I start heading up the triangular face. We left about 9 o'clock that night, and there was probably 50 people ahead of us. These days, that was a crowd. Those days, that was a crowd. These days, it's nothing. We got up to the base of the face, started heading up. There was probably 20 or 30 people ahead of us. We could see the headlamps. Kami just stopped, turned around and looked at me, didn't say a word. Unclipped from the fixed rope, which is a big no-no. He looked at me, nodded his head up towards the balcony, and I knew what he wanted to do. We're going to unclip, we're going to pass the crowds and get ahead of them. Miriam and Mingma had already done that. So now we were number 2, 3, and 4 leading to the summit. Got up to the balcony in 3 hours. Unbelievable. Last time it had taken me 6 hours. I wouldn't even make it all the way. I turned around. My confidence was soaring. Changed oxygen bottles, started heading up the Southeast Ridge. I've talked a lot about this various narratives and this fictional story. Southeast Ridge is a part of Everest that no one ever talks about. Got about halfway up, crampon on rock. Take a step, slide. Oh my gosh. Anyway, overcame that. Winds began to pick up. 30 miles an hour winds with minus 20 Fahrenheit. That makes the wind chill about minus 40. It's cold. It's cold. You know, the down suit I'm wearing, I had bought back for Troy OU in 1998. So it was about 10 years old. The fabric was so thin that on the Geneva Spur, I sat down on some rocks to take a rest. And I ripped the seat of my down suit. Feathers were coming out of my butt like crazy. It looked like I'd eaten a full chicken without plucking it. And I had diarrhea. There was an Italian film crew there filming another Italian climber, and they turned the camera on me as I started heading up with down feathers flying out the back of my down suit. The downside of that was that I had lost some down and I was getting cold. So I ended up pulling out my feathered friend's 850 fill jacket to put on top of my down suit. Yeah, I was a case study in what not to do. My style needed improvement, as my third grade teacher would have told me. Got to the South Summit. Oh, it was dark. It was still pitch dark, but I knew I was going to summit. Kami and I down climbed. We crossed the Cornish Traverse in the dark. Couldn't see a thing. Headlamp on. All my eyes were just fixated on that fixed rope in front of me. Take a step. Push the Jumar. Take a step. Short, simple steps. That was my mantra. Came to the Hillary Step. This is the old Hillary Step before the earthquake destroyed it in 2015. I was a little apprehensive about it because I knew it would be rock climbing at almost 29,000 feet. I was actually very nervous about it. Came up to it and there were some fixed ropes hanging down. Jumar clipped in, safety carabiner on top. I stemmed, right foot on rock, then a left foot higher. Right foot higher, left foot higher. Grabbed the Jumar, tugged it, pushed my legs. I overcame the Hillary Step. It was easier than I thought. Got to the top of the step. Can't be that far to the summit. Kept going. Got to the over a little hill. I thought this must be it. Nope. Lots of headlamps ahead. Goes up and down, up and down, sort of like the back of a dragon, big old fin sticking up. Pretty soon I got a little bit further, and just to my right, sliver of light. It was like a big curtain in an auditorium, bright lights on the stage behind the curtain. They were lifting the curtain really slowly. It was becoming lighter and lighter. I looked to my right and I saw the cornice. I saw cornices being gently kissed by the sunlight, the morning sun. Good morning, Mount Everest. Kept walking on the fixed rope now, taking a step, sliding the Jumar, short, simple steps. Control your breathing, control your emotions. I was about to fall apart. I was so close, so close. Kami was ahead of me. I was a fast follower. I was clipped in independently, not to him, to the fixed rope. I looked ahead. Miriam and Mingma were up there, but also 20 other people were up there. Where did they come from? Oh, I couldn't figure it out. Pulled up, got almost to the summit. A lot of prayer flags up there. A lot of people congratulating each other, hugging, big smiles, laughing. A lot of pictures being taken. Still couldn't figure out where these people came from. The Sherpas had built a little snow bench. I sat down on it, took off my mask, looked at Kami. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Stood up. We hugged for a long time. He grabbed my camera. I'd actually dropped my camera going right underneath the yellow band. Kami had gone down 300 feet down the Lhotse face to get my camera. Oh, what a sad tale I am. But he didn't give me my camera back. He kept my camera. He didn't want me to lose it again. So he took my picture holding Flat Stanley, school in Florida. Asked me if I'd take Flat Stanley to the summit of Everest. I said, sure. Who's Flat Stanley? It's a great picture. And then I just paused. I pulled my down suit hood over my head. My chin dropped to my chest. And I remember thinking, why am I here? I'm not here to stand on top of a rock and claim that I had conquered Mount Everest. I wasn't here to tell the world how great a climber I was, because that would have been not true. I was here due to the help, the generosity, the aid of others. But I'd climbed a mountain myself. I was proud. But I was also humbled that I had actually made it. I had this contradiction of emotions. I was sad. I was happy. I was grateful. I was at peace. But I knew also had to get down. And I sat there with this flood of emotions rushing through my head and my heart. Tears began to just flow down my face freely. I didn't stop them. I wasn't ashamed. I wasn't embarrassed. I was alive. I was grateful. I thought about Ida. I thought about all the ways that she had inspired me throughout my life. I thought about how every time I come back from a big climb, she'd say, well, I'm glad you got that out of your system. I had to grin to myself sitting on the summit of Mount Everest. It was time to go. My thin, empty down suit was not holding up well at 29,000 feet. So I zipped up the feathered friend's jacket on top of my North Face down suit, pulled up my mittens, clipped back in, and Kami and I started heading back down. Climb on. This is Alan. And remember, memories are everything.